So, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming to the last seminar of the semester. Kenneth, we spared no expenses bringing in today's speaker from a long distance. But it's my pleasure to introduce our speaker. In fact, to introduce Kenneth, it doesn't take one introduction, it takes two. So both Mike and I are going to present some stuff. So I thought I'd show the pictures first and then let you hear a little bit more about it, because it'll be fun to have his picture on the thing. So Kenneth Cole, I've now introduced him, or been the kind of the MC, three different times. Once when he stopped being the director. The second when he retired, whenever we did that party, I can't remember, in this room, some time back, a month or two or so, and now. So, I've shown kind of these pictures before, but Diana came to my office and said, "You gotta see this." So she handed me this picture. So here's Kenneth Cole, kind of now. It's not really now. That's kind of an older picture, and Kenneth can tell you the story behind this. But this is a Billy for Kenneth to go get surplus gear. Federal gear that is no longer used by the federal government, but now they make it surplus, and there's a hierarchy who gets to go get it. Yes. So you can see the sponsoring agency, Office of Naval Research, is down below. Okay, but that's him before, but now if you go backwards in time a little bit, this is the real Kenneth Cole, let me tell you. Okay, anyway, so a little bit of background on Kenneth. Kenneth got his bachelor degree and PhD from UC Santa Cruz. Shortly after that, he became a postdoc here at Moss Landing Marine Labs and started working with John Martin. That led to 10 years of shenanigans with the Martin group, doing all kinds of different things, of which today you're probably going to hear some of those descriptions of what it's like to be a chief scientist on cruises in the Southern Ocean and all over the world, as Kenneth played with a whole bunch of different people, international people, including John Martin's group here at Moss Landing Marine Labs, to do a variety of different work on iron experiments and a variety of different things, which he'll probably talk to you a little bit about. So that got him to Moss Landing. Then he became director of the lab and was director of the lab for a little over 12 years. And then became a faculty member, has been faculty member for seven-ish so years. And he's also, during that time, I think about a couple years ago, two or three years ago, became a fellow of AAAS, which is a very highly prestigious sort of honor to be bestowed on him. But he's also, as you know, a very good mentor, an excellent faculty member. He's been a really important person associated with this lab. And he describes himself as a biogeochemist, which, you know, when the chemists start describing all the other fields into their title, it's sort of like, okay, I can do anything. And to some extent, Kenneth can. So we're really happy to have him come and describe what he's been doing as an ocean-going scientist. And I think that's about it for me. I just wanted to give you a history of how he got to this spot. And Mike's going to give you an idea why this talk is important. I'll leave it up right there.
Yeah, that's how I remember Kenneth when I first met him. It's the one on the left. I wanted to, Kenneth and Jim have both been my boss. I wanted to speak about this talk that he's going to give from the perspective of a crew member. I've been everything from a deckhand to the captain, Marine superintendent on the research vessels here. And one of the things that's most important for a successful cruise is a good relationship and a good working partnership between the crew, the technicians, and the scientific party. And the chief scientist is a key factor in that role. And it has to do with planning. It has to do with involving the crew and the technicians in what your science is about, why you're doing it, what your goals are. Have a plan, and also have a backup plan. You can't change your plans if you don't have a plan in the first place. And Mother Nature, the ocean, the equipment on the ship, the people on the ship, or new discoveries that you might find while you're doing your research are all going to change your plan. So it's never going to go the way you originally thought. But having a good plan and having a good rapport with the crew is key, and that's something Kenneth has always done, and I think he'll probably tell you how to do that from his perspective. Thanks.
All right, so welcome, Kenneth.
That was my authorization to scavenge state equipment, and the one on the left was authorization to scavenge federal equipment. And there were about... Well, thank you. Thanks for that. Appreciate that. And nice to see all the faces. There's way too many people here to listen to this talk. Allison asked me to give a talk sort of about life skills in the sciences, and I thought about being a chief scientist, and I thought, well, I guess I do have some experience doing that, but I never went to chief scientist training school, very few people have. They only started having that training program through the UNALS office over the last couple of years. So what I'm going to talk about today is some elements of that training program, and it's going to be peppered by some of your experience sailing on a vessel and having a really good chief scientist or a really bad one, and what the responsibility is about. And you can't just watch a presentation like this and go off and write a proposal to NSF and start being a chief scientist. Maybe you can if you're lucky, but I think the best thing you can do for yourself if you want to get involved in this is get out on some vessels. They don't have to be UNALS vessels. They can be the vessels around here. Our vessels are really good training for that. And if you don't get, even if you don't end up being a chief scientist on a large oceanographic expedition, this is kind of about leadership, and all of you have led field efforts, or will be coming. Many of you will be leading field efforts of your own. So some of the things that are aspects of a good chief scientist will be aspects of a anyone leading a field effort. And I'm just tell you what they are right now. You got to listen carefully to what your team members need. You got to be sensitive to their top priority in terms of their mission. You've got to advocate for their science, not just yours. And you can't be an asshole. So so that that there, I mean, if a lot of many of the chief scientists that I've sailed with have forgotten that last part, and it kind of screws up the buzz aboard the ship, and as Mike said, the relationship between the scientists and the crew of the ship is really important, and so if you can keep that going, you'll be in better shape. So take advantage of those opportunities that present themselves.
That's on the far right.
Oh yeah. Okay. So, yeah, that's me.
That's John Martin with a special wheelchair right there.
Well, that represents sort of an eclectic blend of people who think they know what they're doing. Okay. In this presentation, I intend to go over what is generally the responsibility of a chief scientist, sort of from a UNALS perspective. Many of you have experience on NOAA vessels, especially if you're doing fisheries research. I'm not going to talk too much about NOAA vessels, but there's opportunities to get aboard NOAA vessels and also get aboard other fishing vessels as an observer. So I think you should, if that's in your stars, you should think about it. The responsibilities of a chief scientist are everything. You are in charge of everything. And I think the captain thinks they are, but it's only the captain's ship while everything's working great. It's the chief engineer's ship when things break. And it's actually the cook's ship most of every other time. So you should be aware of those hierarchies. You should also become aware of the watches that the crew members stand. Typically, a captain will stand, say, a 8 to 12 watch. Chief engineers will stand a 12-hour on, 12-hour off type of watch. The cook's up all the time. You need to know when the watch changes, because when the watch changes, the information vaporizes. You need to go up on the bridge almost every watch period and let them know what you're doing. And we'll talk about that. When I first started doing this, I was amazed. I could write a proposal, which is basically a scientific idea between your ears, or in silico in some way. And you can write a proposal to NSF, and they will let you take out a $100 million research platform to do your stuff. It's the greatest thing. You can take it to the Antarctic. You can take it to subarctic Pacific. You can take it to equatorial Pacific, even better. So these are assets that are at your disposal for the research that you want to do. And I think it's a tremendous thing that at least part of our government still sort of works this way. So I want to talk about how you develop those opportunities. And they're not just for you, but they're for your students. You know, they're for your colleagues and other international collaborators. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the proposal itself, science planning, logistics. And then at the end, I want to talk about problems that arise at sea. Things that you should be anticipating. So in developing your proposal, you need to ask the question, are you asking good questions? And the other thing, my feeling is that a lot of good oceanography takes place behind the screen of a terminal. But it's very difficult to ask appropriate and important questions if one doesn't have a sense for the natural history of the environment. And being at sea sort of enables you to see how the natural world works, and it enables you to ask more appropriate questions. So get outside, get yourself some time on a vessel, and see how the oceans really work. From a proposal perspective, the questions you have to ask is it essential to the scientific objectives? Is it novel, feasible, cost-effective? We're going to throw cost-effectiveness out the window when you see the price it takes to operate some of these vessels. Could your project be an ancillary project? Could you pile on or piggyback on somebody else's project? You'll need to show that you can make good use of the capabilities of the research vessel you're requesting, because for damn sure the people at NSF are going to be asking that same question. Okay, so you determine, or somebody determines, that going to sea and making observations or conducting shipboard experiments is essential to your program. Then you have to ask, does a seagoing work propose or require normal ship scientific equipment? And they kind of come with their own bag of tricks. Or does it require essential equipment or other resources provided by others? And what I mean by that is, if the answer is two, it's going to require some crazy-ass equipment that maybe doesn't exist yet, then you have to carefully plan for this with colleagues during the proposal stage. Line up your ducks so you can make sure that you're able to solve that problem when it comes around. include support levels, carefully budget for these resources, including any technical assistance that any special technicians that might be required. Now, when John Martin died and his grants were transferred to myself and Ken Johnson, we had no equipment built for the first IronX experiment that was going to happen 4 months from then. And it was really a factor of getting Steve Fitzwater, getting Craig Hunter, Mike Gordon, Sarah Tanner involved in diving in on this problem, and finally we were able to load about two semis full of equipment that were fabricated here in Salinas and here at Moss Landing Marine Labs. We totally violated that principle, but we got our ship on our ship with a T on board the ship. So this is how you're supposed to do it, not how it is necessarily done. But there's an incredible organization that is there to support you, not just provide the vessels, but some of the technical assistance and much of the equipment that you would be using. And that is an organization called the University National Oceanographic Laboratory System. And it's an organization of academic institutions and some national labs who coordinate oceanographic platforms for research purposes. And they are located in these locations throughout the country. The operator institutions, those people with a platform, are indicated by the red ships. All the coastal states are indicated in light blue. And you can see there's a lot more lobbying money going to the East Coast than there is necessarily in the West Coast. And we're trying to fix that. The yellow dots indicate non-operator institutions. So we are now a non-operator institution. And you can see there's also the states with a shoreline along the Great Lakes are also considered coastal in this image. Okay. So what are these research platforms that are provided? And this is sort of a table. This is a recent table of current UNOLS assets, and it includes some NOAA assets and some US Coast Guard icebreakers. This is a current list. The larger ones cost on the order of $70,000 a day to operate. The smaller ones between $7,000 and $10,000 a day to operate, and the icebreaker is a little bit more expensive. Probably the Marcus Langseth is also very expensive, just because they have 60 crew on that vessel. The thing about going for a UNOLS vessel in your proposal that you're going to write, Lindsay, when you grow up and get your thesis, is that the cost of operations doesn't go into your proposal. It's separate from that. So you don't have to say, oh, and I'm gonna need $70,000 a day for the ship I'm gonna use, right? So it's a wonderful thing. These are assets available to you. So what do they look like? This is the Roger Revelle out of Scripps Institution of Oceanography. It's 274 feet. It's about 3,000 tons. We've used this extensively as part of the JGOF's ASOPS program and also for the Southern Ocean IronX experiment. Takes a crew of about 37 scientists and a ship's crew of about 21. So there's a lot of people and a lot of resources involved in this. Cruising speed is 11.7 knots. And you think, a ship that big ought to be able to go faster than that. We know container ships that go faster than that. Well, it can go 15 knots, and it's about double the price to go 15 knots than it is 11.7. In fact, we were trying to increase the rate at which we could move the ship in order to map our experiment, and we had to get special permission from NSF that they would cover the extra fuel costs. So this is the kind of thing that you should be thinking about. If you want to go out and do a series of hand plankton tows for your thesis or your research, or deploy a couple of sediment traps, Colleen, maybe you don't need a vessel like this. Maybe you need a vessel like this. The former UNALS vessel, this is a regional class vessel, whereas the former was global, points are 135 feet, 500 tons, scientific crew of 12, takes a crew of between, of around 8 to operate. So it's more like $10,000 a day. Its range is 10,000 miles, has a duration of around 3 weeks, which is limited by space in the freezer and refrigerator, the ability to provide fresh meals. This is a very economical and versatile. So those are sort of two ends of the UNALS vessels. Other vessels like the Palmer, which is coordinated through polar programs at NSF, is an awesome vessel to be on. One of the problems with this vessel is the galley is right at the waterline, and so when you're having dinner down there, it feels like you're in a 3-week-long car crash when you're breaking ice. If you can imagine what that, I mean, it really is like that. You can't hear, you can't talk to the person sitting right across from you. But it's a very capable vessel. I'll talk a little bit more about life aboard the Palmer a little later, but remind me if I forget. It's got an all Cajun crew and officers, and the cook's Cajun as well, so Cajun cooking figures heavily in the operation of that vessel. If you're into seismic work, the Marcus Langseth is sort of a ship dedicated to seismic surveys, so it can deploy a series of streamers that are around 2 kilometers long, and so its time is generally focused on seismic work. Some of you, for your thesis, are using samples collected by the JOIDES Resolution. This is coordinated through the Deep Sea Drilling Program. It is around 425 feet long and about 200 feet tall. And so this goes out on dedicated cruises. It takes a little while to do a cast with this vessel. So Ivana's been chief scientist on this vessel. I want to talk a little bit about this. I'm going to go back and I talk at the end more about what life is like on these things. But basically, ships are like floating cities. They have their own sewer treatment, freshwater making facilities, power generation plants, propulsion, navigation, winches, cranes, A-frames, laboratories, dining, laundry, library, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, firefighting, communications, emergency response. It's like a spacecraft, and it is conveying you from the nice, safe home and office and laboratory spaces that we work in terrestrially to areas that are pretty inhospitable and in which you cannot survive. So it's like sort of a spacecraft in that regard. When you step aboard a research vessel, you're becoming part of the crew, and you are going to be expected to help out, especially in the in emergency situations. And so this is an example of some of our people on a recent cruise aboard the Sproul, learning how to put out a fire. You knowing how to operate the firefighting equipment, getting in and out of your survival suits, how to muster for a fire drill. So in many ways, you're stepping into that that world that the crew lives in. There are also some specialized platforms. So if you are, and I don't know if Amanda's going to get into this or not, but the Deep Submergence Group at HUI coordinates the operation of the Alvin, Research Submersible Alvin, which has recently undergone a retrofit with a new 10-foot diameter titanium sphere and is undergoing sea trials to increase its certification to full ocean depth of about 5,000 meters. Is that still correct, Mike? For those samples that you need to take above the height of the ship, UNALS coordinates with the Navy to operate the SURPASS Center. And the SURPASS Center is a center for interdisciplinary remote piloted aircraft studies. And they have hangars right out here in Marina at Fritzy Field. So this is an aircraft. In this picture, it's equipped with cloudwater samplers, and we've taken full advantage of that in our fog water and mercury studies. So you'll see it flying around this area, but it can be deployed throughout this hemisphere. So it's a tremendous asset. So you guys should think broadly about the facilities that are available to you. And when you do, don't neglect some planning considerations. If you're working in polar regions, you typically go through the Office of Polar Programs. It takes a little longer to coordinate, as does operating in foreign waters, or if you need specific permits for marine mammals or you want to work in protected areas. So think about that. The picture on the upper right is a picture of the false color image of the Galapagos Islands showing a large chlorophyll plume. So when we wanted to go and conduct the IronX study, this is an iron release sort of fertilization experiment, we needed clearance from Ecuadorian government. And we also had to carry an Ecuadorian observer. There were two aspects of this program. One was a fertilization south of the Galapagos Islands, and one was a study in and around the islands. We didn't need the clearance to do the release experiment. We needed it to study the Galapagos Islands. But if we got within 200 miles of the Galapagos Islands, we needed clearance. We didn't have the clearance when we sailed. We deployed the patch around this, down around here. And it started drifting north, and we didn't have clearance. And so we were radioing, in this case it was University of Miami who was operating the vessel, every day about clearance because our experiment was heading north. And so they would do their mapping every day around the plume, head south, make sure they were outside the 200 mile limit, call in, give their position, and then we go back to study the. Don't tell anybody. That's a that's a secret. The other thing that may not occur to you is sometimes you're operating in military restricted regions. We have a study down in the Southern California borderlands off of San Diego. Well, it turns out that the Navy has a bombing range down there, and you need to get on the radio and talk to an agency called Plead Command. It's like you get on the radio and you pray to these people to allow you to work in your borderlands. And in our case, we were going to deploy a benthic flux chamber to the bottom that would come up a week later. So we needed permission to go into that bombing range, deploy that, get the hell out of Dodge, but then be able to get back in. Well, that means we had to plead twice. And it's just something you need to work into your planning process. You need to know the restrictions with respect and the boundaries, where the boundaries are of the sanctuary, for instance. What sort of permits are required? if you touch the bottom with any sampling, you need a permit. Cordell Bank is also a sanctuary, yet you need to understand your local conditions and where all the marine protected areas are. So that's another job as a chief scientist. And lucky for us, the UNOL's office works with the State Department, so it's not you necessarily that have to get that that clearance, but you have to inform the UNOL's office of what you're trying to do and NSF of what you're trying to do. And there's a whole bunch of people that back there who want to make that, they want to make you successful. So the way you do this is when you write your proposal, you submit a ship time request form and give them an idea of what ships can accommodate your science. The more flexible you can be, the more flexible the scheduling office can be, because there's a group at Scripps that sort of heads up the scheduling for these vessels. And there's a committee at UNOLS that sort of helps out as well. So be specific. You may only need something on the order of a rowboat, which we did for some of our Mercury in Lakes work, or you may need something from a whaler up to a global. So try and be specific as you can about that. The thing to recognize about global ships is that they're on a longer term planning process. These ships spend from 300 to 320 days at sea a year. So they're trying to coordinate the movement of these ships that can help supply your needs. Right now, the way NSF worked is that you can only submit a ship time request form for the August deadline. So you should be communicating with UNOLS and the ship schedulers. Consider combining your trip with another vessel that's going to be in the same area. If there's a funded project, piggyback, which we have accommodated a lot of piggybacking on ours, and we have piggybacked on other people's cruises as well. So the thing to keep in mind is that NSF, UNOLS, and the community will appreciate that you have reached out for sort of added value. So you get funded. Now you start to put together your team. The earlier you put together your team, the better. And the more often you communicate clearly with them, the better. So we're going to talk about cruising and cruise planning after you're funded. One of the best ways to put together a team is to ask the question whether the science activities of your team are complementary with the science activities of other team members, and are they synergistic? Will there be open berths so they can take on people like us, you know, to get more experience at sea? If you do have space, and if you can go to the UNOL site, www.unols.org, you can go there, and there's a page to see what cruises have space for volunteers. So check it out. We might not ever see you again. So in terms of the role as chief scientist, you need to communicate your science objectives clearly and often, and typically hold a pre-cruise meeting and follow up with conference calls. We had, this is especially true for instrumentation as well. During our IronX 2 cruise, this was to the equatorial Pacific for about 42 days. We had two teams of British scientists who took along all their British equipment and got on board and tried to plug it in, and what the hell? They were all 220, 50 phase, or 50 cycles per second power, right? Well, luckily, the Melville was able to dedicate one of their entire generators, detune the frequency to 50 cycles, and it put out 220 volts. So that would, it would have been helpful to know about those requirements ahead of time. But it was an amazing feat of the engineers to be able to put something like that together on short order. And it worked. In your position as a Marine, or chief scientist, your point of contact usually will be the res tech or the Marine tech to sort of handle some of these communications. Oh, I'm going to need this. I'm going to need. Are you going to be using radioisotopes? Are you going to be using this? They're very helpful in that regard. So don't be shy about asking for clarification. Okay, start logistics early. I gave you a bad example of our first IronX cruise where we basically started 4 months before the initial experiment. But there, NSF had said, this isn't gonna work anyway. You know, you're not gonna be able to get this done in one experiment. What you need is a test cruise in the Monterey Bay, and then we'll give you your cruise around the equatorial Pacific, around the Galapagos, but then we're going to get the real work done with a second cruise to the equatorial Pacific, so-called IronX 2. So if you know that, and if you know how you have a high-risk experiment, communicate that to NSF. And you can often get, easily justify a test cruise, often on a smaller vessel, to test out needed equipment, or you can get a piggyback on other programs where you can get time to check out your stuff. There's an equipment pool also available through UNALS, and it's posted on the site. Since about 1995, NSF stopped allowing use of radioisotopes inside the skin of the vessel, for instance. And so, if you're using isotopes for say primary productivity measurements, radio tracers, experiments, you have to request a rad van that gets strapped down onto the outside of the ship. That's where you do all your radioisotope work. Okay. if you're bringing your own equipment and you're going to need it, you better make sure that it works or that you have a backup. For the chief scientist training program that we ran, there was requests among the scientists for a Mach-Ness sampler. I don't know how many of you know what that is, but it's a big old remotely operated plankton net that can capture samples at a variety of different depths. And it's fairly complex to operate. When we received that shipment from the East Coast, came in a box with blown fuses, bad cables, low capacity batteries. It was not necessarily in plug and play condition. So if you're going to need something to work, you better make sure that you have a backup, or you can pretty much have the assurance of your operator that things have been working great. Talk to the chief scientist on the previous cruise, see if that really happened. We had a problem. We had a Mexican observer on our leg from equatorial Pacific back to Acapulco. He wanted to look at currents across the shelf, and he needed an ADCP. And so we checked the current specifications and script said ADCP is working. Well, by the time we got to Tahiti, the ADCP was not working anymore. And that's an example of, had we had a spare, we could have really helped them out. This is an example of some user-supplied equipment. One of our equipment requirements was that we have a trace metal clean class 100 filtered air clean lab that we could, that was devoid of any metal parts that we could strap to the ship. And they thought, what? No, it's, you know, this isn't Coast Guard rated. But I just have to remind you that it doesn't look like their rad van was Coast Guard rated either. In addition, we needed a winch that we could deploy and recover that wouldn't, sample bottles that wouldn't contaminate it. So we had a special winch with Kevlar wire and a Teflon coated block. So this is stuff that you work out with US techs. And the Marine techs on board, they'll try to get your stuff working, but their commitment is to getting their stuff working. So you're the point of contact with all your people. Captain's the point of contact for all the crew on board. So if sooner you get that worked out, I think the better things will go. I make it a point to get up on the bridge every morning as soon as the captain gets up there. If you're standing in 8 to 12, you get up there, you say, here's what's happening, here's the plan of the day, this is what we're doing, do you have any concerns, anything you want me to change before I post it? And I think that helps get the ship behind the project that you're trying to execute. So during the cruise, it's important to have maintain a sense of situational awareness. You got to be able to understand what's how other people's programs are going. You got to see if they're getting people are starting to get run down or getting a little crazy. One way of doing this is by creating what's called the plan of the day. And that's posted typically in the science quarters or down in the science lab, and posted on the bridge every day. And I think the Coast Guard term for this plan of the day is actually the wall of lies, because everything changes. Wall of lies. Okay, good. Okay. I wanted to give you a sense of how this works. Here's a cruise that we recently completed. This was part of our fog, our study of mercury speciation and distribution along the California current. And the processes that control its flux, the flux of methyl mercury from the sea surface into fog and then transport to land. It's a great story, but what I want to do is talk about some of what a plan of the day would look like for a sampling strategy that looks like this. It has two components. We have known stations that we want to go to, and those are all the nearshore stations, because typically there's a fog sampling station nearby, and there's some good rationale for doing that. These outer stations represent our attempt to sample these ephemeral features like downwelling eddies and upwelling eddies. And when you write your cruise plan, you don't know where that's going to be. So there's a stochastic element to this plan of the whole plan of the day thing. And this is what the plan of the day would look like. And this is right off the board from, this was aboard the Point Sur. So it's a smaller vessel. So from 0500 to 0800, secure the fog collectors. And then try and cruise towards the next station. 700, 800 breakfast, then a CTD cast to 1,000 meters, and then from 9 to 11, typically took 2 hours, blue water dives and collection of microlayer samples, so marine snow particles and other samples were taken. Lunch, concurrent with lunch, was the sampling of the bottom with a multi-core sampler, and you know, plankton, mouston. So the idea here is that people are creatures of habit. They want to know what's coming up. They want to know what they're doing. They really want to know when to set their alarm so they can be awake for the next CTD cast. Okay, and you should be aware that on board ship something's happening around the clock. People are up all the time, and so it's interesting with the point, sir. With a scientific crew of around 12, you don't have enough people to be up all the time. So we have to develop a strategy whereby from about 8 in the evening, you tell the captain, go find the fog, right? And then we'll hoist the fog tower. And then from 11 until 5 in the morning, it's the captain's job to collect fog, right? So that means that everyone else who has stuff to do during the day can kind of catch up. Same strategy was true for many of the iron enrichment experiments where we could use the evening periods to map, for instance, where the enriched area was. And here's another reason why. Some of these activities might require 4 hours of prep, right? And if you're asking your team member who's responsible for the collection of data that looks like this, and it takes 4 hours to run a profile, then they're back calculating. Okay, if the CTD cast is at noon, I'm gonna have to be ready by 8, et cetera. So this sort of becomes crisis management whenever that plan changes. So I wanted to go through crisis management a little bit with you, and this is based on how many of you are state employees. All the faculty are, okay? As a state employee, you are a disaster service worker. Did you know that? You can be called to perform disaster service whenever the governor tells you you can. And you fall under the ICS management plan. And did you guys know that? Yeah, okay. Well, I only knew this because I am a disaster service worker for other volunteer work that I do, and I had to go through the ICS training. And the ICS training talks about this concept of span of control. And that means it's like how many people can one person supervise? And if you're chief scientist on a cruise, you gotta bust this up into bite-sized pieces. And you've got an assign, perhaps, a co-chief scientist who's going to take the midnight to 5 o'clock watch for you, right? Well, after 9/11, they did a lot of study on how many people can one person supervise, sort of in a disaster situation, and it's between 3 and 7. Okay, you know, take a look at Jim's job, and how many people report directly to him. It's like way more than that, you know? So optimally, about 5 people, and it's examined here. This is span of control. So a supervisor with 10 subordinates is an ineffective and dangerous situation. I found this out on IronX 2, okay? 37 scientists, everybody coming to me with their little problem, and I was trying to fix it. Right? Here's how it can fall apart. And we'll use Jim as an example. I don't have a big enough budget for my facilities department. Jim, what are you going to do? Oh, he starts working on the facilities. We just lost the truck. What? It sank. How do you sink a truck? this could be my example as a director, yes. And then this one, you know, oh, we need some other, you know, there's some other problem in the facilities. You know, you have to come take a look at this. Seawater system started. And then number 5 comes and goes, where's the copy paper, right? Okay, now where's the copy paper? If you're gonna handle Where's the copy paper? This whole thing is going to fall apart. And so think about this. And think about this when you're in the field and you're trying to coordinate a large program. You need a system like that, right? You need a number of reports. You need to identify a point person on every team you've got that you're going to coordinate with. Okay, keeping your balance. Stuff is going to go right. Don't lose track of that. Stuff is going to go right. It's going to be awesome, but there's going to be other stuff's going to happen too. So you just have to be aware of that, and especially with small ships. I don't know. It took us 2 days to try and get around Point Arena on the Sur, and so we had to just kind of make plans. We had to hope too and read books for several days. It's also important, I mean, you're responsible for everything, so leave room for recreational activity. Here's Bob Bidgary, University of Hawaii on the left, making Chinese fried buns for the crew. This is a time when on the Melville, the scientists took over the kitchen and made dinner for everybody. And this was the running debate between Bill Coughlin and Mark Brzezinski. And everyone had their little icons, which lent gaiety to the crew as well. So there's going to be a lot. I mean, you've just taken a multi-million-dollar trip, and you owe it to provide a post-cruise assessment, a post-cruise report, and there's an opportunity for a science meeting, and there's also a requirement for data sharing. And so for the post-cruise assessment, it's important that you tell the truth, but you don't be an asshole. That is, you should make constructive praise and constructive criticism. Your time to complain about that that cruise vanished when you set foot on the dock, right? There is a requirement through NSF, if you've collected data, to turn it over to the Rolling Deck to Repository, the data archiving program, within 2 years of your trip. And it's, I think, up to you as someone who just commanded a multi-million dollar platform to make sure that you get your stuff published and you get the data that you collected out there as soon as possible. Now, there's a couple ways that I want to talk about problems, because you will also be responsible for those. And they're almost all people problems. I mean, there's some equipment and weather problems, but they're almost all people problems. Trying to do too much with too few people, et cetera, et cetera. You can't necessarily guess them all. But there's a way in which I'd like you to think about being at sea that you can sort of demonstrate this. We blew the number three engine on the Melville during our Southern Ocean Iron X experiment. And what you can see is the number three engine being torn apart here by the crew on a rocking ship, and the engineers are working overtime to pull the valve covers, look at the plates. They found that the crankshaft had broken in half. Luckily for the Melville, it's got more than three engines, and they could bring engine four and five online, but the engine room was full of pistons and rings and valves, and by the time we got back to New Zealand, they had towed out that crankshaft, and I thought, damn, that would make a nice looking mailbox. And so welded it back, I mean, got it back here, because we had an empty flat rack for all our equipment. They just loaded it on there, welded it back together, and that's my awesome mailbox, folks. So that's how you kind of... I think we each sent them the picture. I sent them the picture. This is kind of hard to read, but how many of you have spent some time at CL, Board of Large Research Vessel? Okay. How many of those people have been out for more than a week? All right. So you'll understand this. And the rest of you, you'll understand it when you get out there. The environment of the ship is unique. It's inherently dangerous. I mean, you are in a constantly accelerated frame of reference, okay? Anything that you don't have tied down is gonna be playing bumper cars, either with you in the lab or with you on the deck. This was a Woods Hole container, their mooring container, that was strapped to the deck of the Palmer, and it broke loose in some heavy swell. I mean 70-foot seas. And so that now we have bumper cars on the fantail that are starting to crash into our van. You know, our nice little van, you know, that one, little fiberglass one, no metal. It was like bowling balls versus the Dixie cup. And the question was, how do you grab it and secure it so that we can get to the ice edge where it's calm? Well, that doesn't happen. That doesn't happen in terrestrial systems. Seasickness is common. On that same cruise, in those 70-foot swells, all the scientists were confined to their quarters, and they passed out bottles of water so that we wouldn't be dehydrated, because if you get too dehydrated, that's a medevac situation, and we are 1,200 miles from land, okay? You're isolated from terrestrial comforts. That is, you can't get away. You can't get home and recharge after work. You're separated from your loved ones. Your network access is limited because it's satellite connection, so there's no cat videos to watch. So it's like being in a pressure cooker. And stuff happens in a pressure cooker. I can think of many shipboard romances that have taken place because of that unusual sort of isolated environment. How many of you know of shipboard romances? Okay, so you know what I'm talking about. There's also a high rate of sexual harassment reported. And this is something that the UNALS fleet just became aware of maybe about 8 years ago. And that's because Woods Hole did a survey. And I'll say 30 years ago, the problem with respect to sexual harassment was crew on scientist sexual harassment, okay? And I've been involved in sort of mitigating some of those problems for some cruises. The problems that showed up in the Woods Hole survey was that the vast majority of sexual harassment was scientist on scientist, inappropriate behavior. Okay, so I, as a member of the UNALS Council, I was brought in to start developing sexual harassment training for this specific environment. And they finally came up with a program, but it's all about protecting the industry from lawsuits. It's not about protecting individuals so much. So it's something up. Okay, good. So that's something that has just been, I don't know how many of you saw that article in Science magazine around 2014 where sexual harassment was identified as being a problem among, in this case it was archaeological workers. And there it was scientist on scientist. So your sense of what's appropriate is is twisted. You're not quite the same person. And so Yunals has and unable to necessarily gauge the type of interactions that you're witnessing. It's different, and it can be dangerous. So Yunals is in the process of developing a new program on maintaining an environment of respect aboard ships, and that looks like it's a much more holistic approach to help people develop respectful forms of interaction. And it will help you and everywhere you are in the field, at home, and on a research vessel. So I encourage you to take a look at this. I don't think we have time. There's a chief scientist training program video that was put together for the program that Mike and I had just developed. And it's awesome, so you should take a look. So anyway, I'd like to end it there and say that you really owe it to yourself to get out to sea. And this is sort of a behind the scenes, like a lot of you aren't gonna have to worry about anything. You're gonna have to just show up, right? But this is some of the stuff that's going on behind the scenes that the chief scientist is having to think about. So I understand there's beer. So yeah, thanks Kim for that. And thanks to the Ichthyology Lab for all the food. Any other, Mike?
Just a comment that in the planning stuff, you talked about your points of contact, but can't emphasize enough, early contact, even during the time when you're thinking about your proposal and how you can put it together, contact the operators of the ships that you're thinking about using to make sure that you're covering all your bases.
All right. Anyone else? Yeah, Lindsay, sorry.
What was your favorite?
Oh, that's hard. I mean, it was probably, I don't know,
it's on the Cayuse, I'm sure.
Well, that was an awesome, that was actually quite an awesome cruise as well. There are many, I think, in the answer to your question. All the trips aboard the icebreakers into the Southern Ocean, they represent the audacity of nature. You know, if anyone has a chance to get to the Antarctic, jump on it. From a scientific perspective, I think the IRON-X 2 to the Equatorial Pacific, the second iron enrichment experiment, was one of the most formative, scientifically, most publications. I really enjoyed these fog cruises that we just got off of in the on the Point Sur, you know, with your own gang. That was really a nice feeling. I really enjoyed sailing with Rick Berlini, the captain of that vessel. That crew is the best crew I've ever sailed with. And that was great for those reasons. So, I mean, they're all different. You know, this transit, you know, you can piggyback, I didn't mention this, you can piggyback on a vessel when it's done its operation over here and it's steaming back to its home port over here. I think it was Drew and Alex and Holly who took advantage of a trip from Dutch Harbor to Moss Landing aboard the, so we flew them up to Dutch Harbor and they got on board and they had a trip all the way back. And I think that was helpful for your sea legs. Those are opportunities, and those types of transit opportunities are also listed on the UNOLS website.
Thank you.
All right.
Is the food CERS still a UNOL vote now?
No. No, NSF wanted to get it out of the UNOL's fleet, and so it was sold to a consortium, and University of Southern Mississippi is operating now. And it's being used quite a bit to soak up all the BP money in the Gulf of Mexico right now. And so I think it's been very successful at doing so. Amanda.
I have tons of questions, but generally, if you want to use a ship, you talk to UNOS early and figure out things like where you would set sail from,
yes.
Or do you always take off from wherever its home institution is?
That depends on the ship you're using and its schedule. So sometimes you'll have to write in travel money to get to, for instance, when we took the Oceanus from Port Hueneme up to Newport. Well, we had to get all our crap down to Port Hueneme, then we had to get it all back from Newport, you know. And so you don't always get a Moss Landing to Moss Landing type of arrangement.
Well, that's another reason to talk to the operator early on, and if it's a global ship, you know, you don't even know which ship you're going to end up on. And you need to be flexible, like Kenneth said.
Yeah, so we had a very narrow weather window for the Southern Ocean Iron Enrichment Experiment, and we needed two global class vessels and an icebreaker. And it took 5 years to schedule that. And during which time the New Zealanders went out and just did their experiment. So. Crap. Anyway, hey, I think I'll take any other questions over a beer. So thanks all for your patience.